So please let us welcome Philippe Aghion up on stage with a warm applaud. And it's time for the prize lecture, Rethinking Growth Enigma, a Schumpeterian Perspective. Please, Philippe, the floor is yours.
So I wanted to take just two anecdotes, which I hope will not be counted as in the 40 minutes. I'm cheating already. You know, a few years back, I had been invited. You know, the Handelskolon was organizing a big event, and it was started by a singer. She was a well-known singer, and she was a choreographic singer. And she was essentially making love with the floor. I mean, it was a kind of very, you know, with the, and I was supposed to speak right after. And so I said, God, how can I be not deadly boring after that? I mean, you, when you see such a, and I what I found is to say, well, you know, the US, they have growth, France has love, and if we could reconcile the two or something like this, and to remain in the same, it's very always hard to start with after good art. Another story I have to tell is about a TV political journalist, Jean-Pierre Elkabbach, I don't know if you know. He was a well-known political journalist on French TV, and always looks very sure of himself. And one day I met him because he was interviewing some, you know, friend, someone who has asked me to come and be there when he was being interviewed. And to my surprise, this journalist came to me and I said, in French, j'ai le trac. I am nervous. And that is somebody I would never suspect he would be nervous. He would be always so sure of himself. And he said, you know, each time I have to give a speech, I am nervous like the first time. And I feel exactly the same now. And the only thing that will help me overcome my nervousness is because I'm very impatient to convey to you a number of crazy ideas I have about economics, about, you know, and so that compensates, you know, that will try to offset this nervousness I have. So I gave the Rethinking Growth Economics, the Schumpeterian Perspective. So this lecture is the story of an intellectual journey, and which Peter Howitt, my co-author, whom I met at MIT in the summer of 1987, and I initiated almost 30 years ago, it was in the summer 1987, when we decided to elaborate a new theory, a Schumpeterian theory of economic growth. And it is the story of why and how, starting with the ambition of transforming growth theory, that was our ambition, at the end, it is us who have been transformed. In particular, I will try to convey how, you know, starting as pure applied theorists, we ended up doing theory differently. And in fact, we established a dialogue with empiricists. We learned to do theory through a dialogue, through constant back and forth between theory and data, which was not what economic growth theorists were doing at the time. And it is the story of the double transformation of the subject and the object that I want to talk about in the next 40 minutes. So so let me just start with the kind of basic paradigm that we laid out. So it started, it was inspired very much by this guy. I don't want to make a joke that I make, because I tried to reduce the number of jokes. I had many more jokes in view, but this one I will skip for questions. We took three ideas, because at the time, you see, the dominant model was a neoclassical growth model. But the neoclassical growth model was very elegant, but it would not tell you much about, you know, the big mysteries of growth. It would not tell you much about, you know, the drivers of growth. It would not tell you much about how you do growth policy. And but you see, when I was a student, people would mention this guy Schumpeter, and they would say, well, you know, there are some ideas there. And the feeling was that, but where is the model? Where is the empirics? And so what we try to do with Howitt is to say, let's build a model that embodies these ideas that seem very inspiring and which we see nowhere in a model. So the first idea is that growth is driven by innovation. Okay, long-run growth is primarily generated by innovation. I mean, you cannot just grow through capital accumulation. If you just accumulate capital, as Robert Solow showed, you run out of steam. You need innovation. Okay, so that's the first idea. The second idea is that innovations do not come from heaven. They result from entrepreneurial investment. So here is the word entrepreneur. And in particular, think of R&D, think of training, think of all kinds of entrepreneurial investment. But of course, these entrepreneurial investments are motivated by the environment, by the business climate. Policies, institutions will influence growth because they will impact on entrepreneurs' incentives to invest or not in innovation, okay? And this seems a very stupid idea, said like this, but it's very important because it means that innovation-based growth is a social process. And we can talk about policy of growth and about institutions of growth, because policy and institutions, let be property right protection, macroeconomic stability, competition policy, whatever, they will influence tax policy. We'll get back to that in a moment. They impact on growth because they affect entrepreneurs' incentives to invest or not in innovative activities. So that's the whole area of political economy of growth is open to you by this very stupid second sentence that you have on this this sentence. And then the third idea is creative destruction. New innovations replace old technologies. Schumpeterian growth is a conflicting process between the old and the new. It tells the story of previous innovators who became entrenched incumbents, who try to prevent or delay future innovations. And this is the story of this permanent conflict between the old and the new. Therefore, you can talk about the political economy of growth, you see, and that's what's very new. Before, there was no, and other people have built on that, okay? So this is the framework. So first, we started, we had a model, which we did in 87, but which came up in published a few years later. And it was fine. I mean, you know, I think it got attention. But suddenly, you know, when you have a theory, of course, you are being challenged. And one of the challenges came from empiricists, because in fact, one implication of our theory is that if you take it very simplistic, more competition should be bad for growth. Why? Because more competition should reduce the monopoly rents that you make when you innovate. That's a bit the Bill Gates argument. If you have antitrust action against Bill Gates, he said, oh, if you do too much antitrust, you will discourage future Bill Gates, because they will not want to innovate because they will have antitrust authorities. You see what I mean? And that was the prediction of this kind of model that, you know, and our model in particular, that more competition would be bad for growth. But it turns out that empirical work had been done by, in particular, this guy, Richard Blondel, and his team at the Institute of Fiscal Studies. And they used UK firm-level data. Now, you could say UK is different from any other countries. No, it's not. It's a very reasonable country, you know. The French always want to say that Britain is different, but it's a very reasonable country. And what Blondel showed is that using firm-level data, he saw that firms in more competitive environment would grow faster, they would innovate more, and have higher productivity growth. So he found an empirics that was totally different, opposite to the prediction of the model. So then you can have three types of attitude. One attitude is to say you tear up the model, you say, I was totally wrong, forget about the model. The second attitude is to say the data are wrong. Okay? And the reality is wrong. And I'm right, you see? A number of politicians who are like that say the reality is wrong and they are right. And you forget about the empirics, and that's what a number of other people would do. And the third thing is to say, no, let's go back to the model and try to see whether in the model there were some assumptions that were maybe too restrictive and that explain why we had this divorce between the theory and the empirics. And that's why I want to tell you this story, because I want to tell you how we came to work with empiricists, you see? How we get back closer to them. And so we went back to the theory, and we realized in fact that there was something that we had not seen in the basic model we had. An innovator was something that initially was not an active firm, would innovate, would make a rent. So competition would deter innovation because it would reduce the rent from innovating. But innovation would always be made by outsiders, by people who are not active. You see, the active firms would not innovate in our basic models. But in practice, we know that innovation is made both by frontier firms who are already active and making profits, and non-active firms that are behind. And there are the two kinds of firms. And competition doesn't have the same effect on the two kinds. Just to tell you a story. Imagine that you are a classroom. Okay? And imagine you are all very good here. I can see. But suppose that some are better than others as students, okay? Suppose you have the top of the class, and suppose you have the bottom of the class. And suppose now that I open that door, and I make a good student enter the class, and compete with you. What will happen? The best students will work harder to escape the competition with this guy, to remain the best people. And they will be fostered by this new guy. But those who are in the bottom of the class, in France, we say près du chauffage central, next to the heating system. They will work less well because they will say, God, we are discouraged. Already we were discouraged because we were laggards. And now that this guy, who is so very good, is entering, we are even more discouraged. And so, and in fact, I have a colleague, Caroline Hawksby, who showed exactly that you have this kind of effect. You bring a good student in a classroom, the good existing students do better, and those who are in the bottom do worse. And in fact, what's amazing is that firms are like people. Firms are like students. You increase competition, and that's the work that we've done with Blondel. We use firm-level data, and we understood now. We had a model, and in our model, extended model, you would have both frontier firms and laggard firms in the economy and reacting differently to competition. And we saw that, in fact, the blue line is how firms that are close to the technology frontier in their sector react to more competition, to more entry. They work harder. You see, they innovate more to escape the competition. This is this curve, whereas the orange curve is the non-frontier firms, the firms that are far below the technology frontier in their sector. Typically, when there is more competition, they are discouraged. And you see, and you have both effects at the same time of competition. But now you can say, overall, what do you have? And overall, what you get is an inverted U. For low levels of competition, is the escape competition effect that dominates, and for high level of competition is this discouragement effect that dominates. And you see, we understood much better what was going on. And we tested this theory, this extended theory, on the same data with Blondel. We work with this guy and Rachel Griffiths and all the team of Institute of Fiscal Studies in London. And you see, this exercise, why was it important? It was important because, in fact, you see, for on their side, they realized that the relationship between competition and growth was more subtle than the pure increasing that they have found. They saw that you had this opposite effect, reaction of frontier firm and non-frontier firm, and that, in fact, the overall was an inverted U. So that's not something they would have suspected. And on our side, we enriched our model by introducing innovation by frontier and non-frontier and understand that you had, in fact, different effects of competition and that you could see when one effect dominates or the other effect dominates. And in particular, that would tell you that in a more frontier country, where you have mainly frontier firms, you react very positively growth to competition, whereas in a country which is not frontier, where most firms are laggards, you don't react so positively to competition. Already the idea that policies are more or less good for growth depending on how advanced the country is. You see, that's what does this interaction with empiricists. And since then, I always done growth interacting with empiricists, you see. That's the way we work. That's the way we enrich models through back and forth between empirics and modeling of economic growth, okay? That's, are you still alive? God, miracle. So then let me go to growth enigma. I was thinking I would do only two, but because there is a joke with the first one, I can't resist. It's the Argentinian paradox. So he said, if you look, you know, at the GDP of Argentina compared to the GDP of the United States, so here I realize that I have Bernadotte's language still on the slides, which I thought I would not. That's bad, but you know. Mother language, I meant. So you see here, essentially, between 1870 and 1870 and 1930, the GDP of Argentina per capita is essentially 40% of the GDP of US, which means that they grow as fast as the US. But then they grow less fast, and they lose 0.21% of growth compared to the US. So there is a décrochage. You see, there is a break, you see. Argentina was doing very well until the 30s, and then they stopped doing well, okay? And the question is, why is that? And you have other countries like that. They do very well for a moment, and then they stop doing well. For another country which is more advanced than middle income, usually we refer to this phenomenon as a middle income trap. Alors, I used to make the joke, yeah, because I was at Harvard, that middle income trap is MIT, but you know, that's that was a bad, you know, that's not at all what I'm... So the thing is that you have other countries who are like that. For example, Japan, where the state was always tightly controlled competition, it was very limited competition, Japan grew very fast between 1945 and 1985, but then Japan has grown much less. So they had institutions, and that's the whole point, is that we developed with Darren Acemoglu and Fabrizio Zilibotti a theory saying, you know, using the Schumpeterian framework, they say, you know, you can grow through imitation or through innovation. And you grow for a while through institutions and policies that are good for imitation, but they may not be adapted for innovation. Japan had good institutions for catching up, but those institutions are not ideal for frontier innovation. They have limited competitions, they have these big conglomerates called keiretsus, and those are impediments to competition. And we know competition is important for frontier growth, you see. I mean, so like France is another example. We were very good during the 30, les 30 glorieuses, the 30 years after World War II, but then we have to change policy and institutions to be able to become innovators, like what you did in Sweden in the 90s, that France still needs to do. And that's the middle income trap. That's one enigma. And I understand why the same policies can be good for growth for a while, and then stop being good for growth, and if you maintain them too long, you stop being very actively growing. You get into a trap, you see, and how you get out of that trap. That's a kind of first enigma. I want to talk about the second enigma, which is the debate on secular stagnation. So in 1938, let me just have some water. Ah, fresh water, it's so fantastic. So the debate over secular stagnation. In 1938, the economist Alvin Hansen explained in his presidential address to the American Economic Association that in his opinion, the United States were bound to experience low growth in the long run. The nation was just emerging from the Great Depression, and Hansen did not anticipate the World War II that would in fact stimulate a rebound in public spending and thereby in aggregate demand. Since then, we have experienced another major financial crisis, the one of 2007-2008. And then there was someone else than Alvin Hansen, there was Larry Summers and others, to revive the expression secular stagnation to characterize a situation that they assimilated to the one described by Hansen in 1938. Summers' argument is that investment demand was so weak that negative interest rates were necessary for a return to full employment. But there is another guy who comes from a different part, and his name is Robert Gordon. And Robert Gordon, he comes from not from in terms of his reasoning is not a demand side reasoning, it's more a supply side reasoning. And Gordon's view is that essentially you have invented everything, that the humanity has invented everything it could. Quoi. And the Gordon view, to make it, you know, I caricature here a bit, of course. His view is that the innovations is like a fruit bearing tree. Have you ever tried to bury? I'm not a guy of, I don't climb trees. I'm you've already here, I have vertigo on this three steps. But so when you try to catch fruits, the fruits that are easiest to catch are very tasty. They are very, you know, they are very good. If you climb the tree very far, and the fruits that you will get there, you know, if you don't fall down and break your leg, are very bitter, you see? So he thinks that innovation is like a fruit-bearing tree. The easiest one are the best one, and then any other ones are the hard one, and they are small ones. And his view is that innovation is the same thing. He said, you know, here I could not show you, but you have here the steam engine, general purpose technology that diffuses, and you were going very high, you see, that's the Alps. Here, you, after the Alps, you have the Jura, and then you have les Vosges, and then you have whatever. And then you have La Montagne Saint-Geneviève, whatever. You see, but the idea is that each new big technology is less and less and less. So Gordon's view is that somehow, that's the steam engine, that's the electricity, that's the computer, and after me, the deluvian, okay? After, you know, this is it, quoi. We can say goodbye to growth and to innovation, okay? That's the basic view that he's advocating, okay? And the question is, why not believe in it? And my argument is in three parts. We can discuss that, by the way. I'd be very happy to have questions, and I want to provoke you. So my first argument is Dale Jorgensen. I have a colleague, Dale Jorgensen, and he says, you know, there is something special with the ICT revolution, the information communication technology, is that in fact it's changed the way we create ideas. We've changed the technologies for producing ideas. Now, you see, I have, with my co-authors, I can use Skype, although I'm not very bad at that. I can use Dropbox. There are many other things that my co-authors use very well, and I don't know how to use, because I'm very much behind the frontier. But now you can collaborate with people very far from you, in California, in Australia. The technology to produce ideas has improved like never. And also the rants to successful innovator. When you innovate now, you have the world market for you. And that, of course, the incentive to innovate is much bigger. And so for both reasons, you should expect more innovation, not less innovation. Okay, so that's the Dale Jorgensen argument. There is another argument, which is the missing growth argument. So there I have Timo, who is in this room. I don't know if you recognize. I just said that that's the best slide of the presentation. So Timo is at the Institute of Advanced of Economic Studies, and he's here. And with Timo and other co-authors, we are arguing that, in fact, you know, the creative destruction, innovations that involve creative destruction, that involve the replacement of current producers by new producers, of current products by new products, they are not properly taken into account by growth statistics, you see? The idea is that we have witnessed an acceleration, in fact, of innovation over the past decades, not a slowdown in innovation. But the problem is that innovation involving creative destruction is not properly taken into account by current measures of TFP growth. Whenever old products are replaced by new products, by new entrants, the statistical office often uses the price changes of surviving products to infer the price change of replaced products. And in fact, using the Schumpeterian growth paradigm to provide explicit expressions for the missing growth, we estimate that the missing growth from creative destruction lies between 0.4 and 1 percentage point per year, which means that the US, if you take that into account, is growing at more than 3% per year, TFP growth. How can you call that stagnation? You see? And of course, we don't deny that there are ups and downs, you see? But just that the current down is at 3%. Just to show you the figure, here I'm representing, you see, on the horizontal axis is the average rate of productivity growth in various states of the US. And in the vertical axis is the number of patent applications per year. And the red line is the states that have low churning. There is low creative destruction, lower than the median, low replacement of old firms by new firms. And in those states, you see a very clear positive correlation between patent and the product measure productivity growth. Whereas in states which are in blue, which are states where you have a lot of churning, a lot of replacement of old firms by new firms, there you see like even a slightly negative relationship between average growth of labor productivity and number of patent application. You can look in terms of sectors, not in terms of states. Same thing. The red line are sectors in the US that have low rates of churning nationally. And the blue sectors are those who have high rate of churning. In the ones where you have low rate of creative destruction, you see a very positive correlation between the rate of innovation and measure productivity growth. Whereas in those that have a lot of churning, you see almost no correlation. Another figure which is very telling, here we rank on the horizontal axis, we rank 16 sectors in the US according to their level of creative destruction, spanning the whole manufacturing industry. So you have sectors here year with low creative destruction, higher and higher creative destruction. And we here, it's the correlation between TFP growth and the number of patents in these sectors. And what we see is that in sectors with low creative destruction, you have a very high correlation between TFP growth and the number of patents. And whereas in sectors where you have high creative destruction, you have a low correlation between TFP growth and the number of patents. You see, that's exactly the reasoning we are pushing. So I think this is a kind of big line of a big counterattack to, to the pessimism. This is it. I mean, forget about growth and that's it. Okay, that's the third argument. And there is a second argument. And the third one is Europe. Europe has the advantages of its drawbacks. And the fact is that, the thing is that you have countries that are well managed, but I come from a country, France, where, we have a lot of rigidities and policies are very much suboptimal. And you see here is Sweden. And you did a number of reforms in the early 90s. You reformed the state. You reformed the fiscal system. And you also had a smart monetary policy at the same time. And you see what happened is that growth accelerated in Sweden. Whereas Japan, as I was telling before, growth is slowing down. And it's not just Sweden. Sweden, you had an average TFP growth rate of 0.4 between 76 and 1992. And the average growth rate of TFP went up to 1.9%. Yearly between 92 and 2008, but there are other countries that reform: Netherlands, Canada, Australia, and each time, the growth rate went up. So I mean, in Europe, we have enormous room for improvement. So there, our problem is just to do the right reforms and the right combination of structural reforms and smart macroeconomic policy. And so that's my third reason for optimism. That's the secular stagnation. Okay. Now I want to talk about the third and last, and then I will conclude, because I think that I want to talk about inequality, innovation, inequality, and social mobility. Are you still alive? Who is dead? Of course, by definition, the dead would not raise their hands, of course. Okay, if you are still alive there, it's great. I mean, I thought we would already be dead by now. So let me talk about the relationship between innovation, inequality, and social mobility. I'm sure all of you have seen this curve that describes the evolution of the share of income earned by the 1% richest people in the US, but you have similar curves in the UK or in the most developed countries over the past since the, the whole 20th century and until now, about the past century. And what you see is that there is an acceleration in the increase in the top 1% income and the share of income of the top 0.1% similar. And the question is, where does it come from? And what I want to argue, because I don't want I want to argue first that, top income inequality is not the same as social mobility and broader measures of inequality like the Gini, but we can argue that. But most importantly, I want to argue that there are various sources of top 1% income, and they are not the same thing. And if you could remember one sentence from this lecture, is that Steve Jobs is not the same as Carlos Slim. And I will explain to you, who Steve Jobs is, but of course, you may not know who Carlos Slim is. I think one day he will get in the room and he will send a tomato on me, and I will explain to you why the various sources are different and why should not treat them all the same way, okay? And why innovation is special? Because innovation generates growth, particularly in frontier economy. But also what we show, also in work with Blondell and other co-authors, is that innovation generates temporary rents. And why are the rents temporary? Because when you are an innovator, eventually you are imitated or you are superseded. There is someone, there is creative destruction, there is someone who does better than you, and your rents are eliminated at that moment. So those rents are typically temporary. So the second thing with innovation is because of creative destruction, we can show that it's positively correlated with social mobility. Particularly, it's innovation by entrance that's positively correlated with social mobility. And the third thing is that we show that innovation does not increase broad inequality in the US. So that's very interesting. Innovation affects top income, but affects differently other measures of inequality. And I don't want to. So the work that I did with, again, Richard Blondel, Ufuk Aksigit, and other, David Emus, who is in Zurich, and Antonin Bergeau, who is a student at the London School of Economics. And we have this kind of curve. So just stare at these curves. Here again, I have the evolution of the share of income of the top 1% in the US since 1960. And you see again the acceleration since 1980. In blue, I represent the number of patents per 1,000 inhabitants. And you can see that the curves are very similar. There is an acceleration in innovation. At the same time, there is an acceleration. Of course, this is no proof of causality, but it's a kind of smoking gun. You say, wow, you know, there is these two curves, and they are very parallel. What we show, in fact, is that in the paper, is that we show there is a causality from innovation to top income, because innovation creates rents. And we show there is a causality from innovation to top income inequality using what we call instrumental variables. What we also show is that there is a positive correlation between innovation and social mobility. How do I measure social mobility? There is high social mobility is my income is not very much correlated to my father's income. There is low social mobility if my income is very much correlated with my father's income. And there's been data in the US by Raj Chetty and co-authors across commuting zone in the US, looking at the income of the parents in the late 90s when the child is 15 years old, and the income of the child when he's 30 years old in 2010, 2013, and they look at the correlation, and you can see with using their data that you have a very positive correlation between innovation and social mobility, and particularly by innovation, by people who start innovating, who have never innovated before, what I call entrant innovation. That's very much in the Schumpeterian spirit. And what's very interesting is the third curve. Here I look at the relationship between, on the one hand, the innovativeness of a state in the US. The same state here might appear in different years. So those are states in the US over the whole period since 1980. And I look, the red curve is the Gini, is the top income share. Alors, you see that the more innovativeness there is in a state, the higher the share of the top 1%. Okay? And the blue curve is the Gini. It's the how far you are from perfect equality, excluding the top 1%. It's a measure of broad inequality. And what's remarkable here is that there is no correlation between innovation and broad inequality. So innovation, of course, increases the top income inequality, but it does not affect global inequality, and it is positively correlated with social mobility. The states that are more socially mobile in the US are California, Massachusetts, where also the share of the top 1% income is highest, and where you have, high mobility. And the least mobile states are Alabama, Mississippi, where also the share of the top 1% is not that high. I know my time is up, but I'm getting there almost. Huh? So the thing is that, as I said, innovation generates growth. It generates temporary rents, it enhances social mobility, does not increase broad inequality. But in contrast, lobbying, and we measure lobbying because we know that various sectors in the US do more or less lobbying, and you know the sectoral composition of the various states in the US, so you can have local measures of lobbying. And what we can show is that lobbying increases top income inequality, like innovation, but it also increases inequality at large, it reduces social mobility, and it does not enhance growth. So this is a bad source of top income. This is Carlos Slim for you. The other one is Steve Jobs. You see? And for example, here is the link between lobbying and the share of the top 1%. You can see that lobbying is also correlated with top 1% inequality, but also lobbying is positively correlated with the Gini coefficient, with broad inequality. And so the thing is that, therefore, you have on the one hand Steve Jobs, who is the innovator, and Carlos Slim. Carlos Slim was a person in Mexico. He might have been an innovator in his young age, but then what happened is that when they privatized Telecom de Mexico, they made it a private, unregulated monopoly. Whenever I would call in Mexico, it would cost me 10 times the time, 10 times as much as when I called in the US, and all was going into pockets of this person. You see what I mean? That's how he was making money. It's very different from Steve Jobs. So it's very important when you think of tax system. We need progressive taxation, but you cannot treat Steve Jobs of this world and Carlos Slim of this world as the same kind of people. Okay, so that's the thing. So I am now getting at the end. I think it's very sad. No, you must think that, you know, you would like me to speak for more hours. I went through various enigmas of economic growth. And what I how long do I have? I'm past for how long? Already, how much have I? I have 5 more minutes? No, really? Oh, God. I thought I was 5 past. Okay. So I would like just to say what's next. It's always difficult to say what's next because it's difficult and risky to try and predict. It's like Gordon cannot tell you when you will have the major next innovation. He believes there will be none. I can be like Gordon and say, après moi le déluge, there will be after Aghion no more innovation in economics, you see, or after other people. And it's always hard to predict the next major innovations, including in the field of economics and growth economics. Nonetheless, we can already perceive new fields of study emerging from the availability of new databases. And the fascinating thing with entrepreneurship economics is now we have new data. So I don't want to bother you. I want to show you now talk about Finland, since I only have 5 minutes. Okay, I will skip. I will go directly to Finland. Okay, so let's move to Finland. Which is that I can't do, unfortunately. That's a co-author of mine. I cannot do. Let's becoming an inventor. And so here I'm talking about joint work that I'm currently doing with Ufuk, who is here, and Pichi, and Otto Toivanen and Arit Vananen. So they are in Finland, and there's been parallel work in the U.S. by Bell, Chetty, Jaravel, and Van Rienen. And what we are going is that with the basic question we are asking, and those were the last minutes where I said I would promise to be fun. What determines who becomes an inventor and what determines the income mobility of inventors versus non-inventors? And you see, the thing is that the new growth theory, the one I showed you, have shed light on the role of institutions and policies which favor or prevent innovation-led growth. However, these models typically assume an economy with ex-ante identical individuals who freely decide whether or not to become innovators. However, in practice, not everybody can become an innovator, okay? And whether you become an innovator may depend on your parents' income, your parents' education, your IQ, your own education. And the question is, what does it depend on? And what will happen to you if you innovate? Okay, so the great thing with Finland, and I'm having a meeting with Torsten Persson and David Stromberg, because we want to try to do something similar with Swedish data, is that we can merge 3 types of data in Finland. We can merge individual data on income, education, and other characteristics from Statistics Finland. In fact, the Statistics Finland tells you also about your parents' income and education, okay? So that's the Statistics Finland, which is a gold mine, okay? Then you have another gold mine. It is the European Patent Office. For each patent, you know the name of the inventor. You know where the inventor patented. And you know the previous patent record of the inventor. How long has he been innovating? What has he done before? How many girlfriends or boyfriends he had? Everything, you know, you can tell with this European Patent Office. And then third, you have the IQ data. That's the great thing. I think in Sweden it's the same. The military service is still compulsory in Sweden? No, no longer. But in Finland, it is. Because they think they can be invaded by Russia any day. So they keep doing the military service. And, you know, there they have an IQ test. And in the IQ test, they do visuospatial IQ, verbal IQ, and quantitative IQ. And then you can look at IQ test. Are you still, Charlie, is that okay? I'm almost done, huh? I'm there. So then you can merge the 3 data sets, and you can look at these things. So here it was it was my friends, the Bell et al., where they have the data on parental income and whether you are innovator or not. And this is the U.S. So in the U.S. they showed on the horizontal axis you have the parental income, the percentile. Here you have a poor parent or rich parent. Okay, and then you have innovations per 10,000, or the probability of innovating. And in the U.S., essentially, you know, where your parental income is up to here, there is almost no innovation. And then when you have a very wealthy or well-off, well-to-do parent, whoop, you see how the probability of innovation goes up. That's the U.S. Now, you might think that in Finland would be very different because you have one of the best education systems, free education for everybody, etc. It's a bit better. This is Finland. You see, so the bit of the difference is that, you see, at least for even you, you start going up lower. You see, it's a bit belly there. There is a kind of belly, you see? So it's a bit higher, but still there is a difference at very high incomes. So even in Finland, having a high income father or mother still to matter. That's amazing in itself. Huh? Now you may say, what's behind this? So what you can do, you can say, first also you have IQ. And what you can see is that there is, you know, when you have you increase IQ, so those are the either the total IQ or the visual spatial, it's very similar figure. Having a higher IQ is very much correlated with a higher probability of invention, particularly at high levels of IQ. It can just be the visual IQ, just see that you, do I see you correctly, you know. Okay, so that's the IQ. And I want to show you something. So I go back to the father income, and there is something we can do, and that Bell et al. Cannot do, because they don't have data on parental education, is that here I decompose. The red is when you have a father with the master in science, and the blue is when you have a father with no master in science. And you see that it goes up, that the probability of inventing goes up with income of the father when you have a father who has a master in science. So if you have a non-educated father or a father that studied poetry, that's not uneducated, it's very important poetry, but that will not help you much for the probability of innovating. You see, if you have a rich poet as a father, that will not be of great help. But if you have a rich engineer or master of science, that will make a big difference. So that's interesting, yeah? That they can't show. Now what you can do, I don't want to show many tables, just the same table. Here I look at the probability of becoming an inventor as a function of having a father in the top income quintile or mother in the top income quintile. And you see, it's very positively correlated. So it matters to have a father in the top quintile, mother to a lesser extent, but still. It's very unfair, by the way. Why not the mother like the father? But anyway, that's the way it is. And now if I control for father and mother education, I see that the coefficient of the father goes down by half and the mother by three times down. So it means that to a large extent, the correlation that we could perceive between parents' income and your probability of becoming an inventor was hiding the fact that the parental income was reflecting the education of your parents that they transmit to you. Do you see what I mean? And that's now what you can do is that I can control for your IQ. I see that IQ matters, and when I control for IQ, father income a little bit goes down, again, a little bit down, but IQ matters as well. And then when I control for my own education, for me having a PhD in science, I see that parent and father education don't matter anymore. And that father income matters much less than before, still a little bit, so maybe connections and things still matter. And so, and still IQ matters. So the story, you can see it, is essentially that it matters to have education. Of course, having a well-to-do father, it matters on you because to a large extent it reflects that your parents are educated and that they give you the education. And this is a huge input to becoming innovating, on top of which there is the effect of IQ, which is the cherry on the cake. And that's the story. But there is still a residual effect of parental income when you control for everything, probably connections or other things like that, or how to know to relate to people. So that's very interesting because you see there is always this debate between what is environment, social environment, and what is innate ability. And here you can get closer to this question. You see, but the big lesson there is education, education, education. Invest massively in Sweden, reform the education system. I know you tried some reform on education. Some of them were good, some of them, you discussed them. You may want to redo them or whatever. Education is very important, is the key input into innovation. Market liberalization is, but both are. And I'm done almost, you see. I know. Yeah. So this is the fact that's the last table. When you are an inventor, this you are much more likely to be top income. If you start from being outside the top 10 income share, if you invent, it increased by 28% the probability that you make to the top income. That means innovative is a fantastic social elevator. The social mobility regression that I had shown on aggregate data before, you find it by following individuals. You see, whenever they innovate, they take the elevator socially and they go up. And so, and you can keep going this way. I will stop there because we have proposed a new theory, but also a new way to do growth theory through continuous dialogue with microempiricists. Our purpose was both to better understand the growth process and also to rethink growth policy. Addressing growth enigmas is useful not only to satisfy our scientific curiosity, but but also for society. Let me cite Alexis de Tocqueville. Alexis de Tocqueville wrote a book called Democracy in America. Of course, you know Tocqueville. And in this book, Alexis de Tocqueville says, "I cannot help fearing that man may reach a point where they look on every new theory as a danger, every innovation as a toilsome trouble, on every social advance as a first step towards revolution, and that as a result they may absolutely refuse to move at all for fear of being carried off their feet." And my hope is that the work we have undertaken over the past 30 years will, and which I try to summarize during this part, 45 minutes, I'm sorry, Magnus, will contribute to dispel this apprehension that Tocqueville expresses. Thank you very much.
Stay here a little bit. Stay with me. Thank you very much, Philippe. Actually, I think there are three more minutes that you
can I do
have
more
used.
Then?
No. Yeah, I'm sorry. No, you lost that opportunity. You know, innovating is about grasping that opportunity. Let me just ask you before we have the panel discussion: the most important policy conclusions. Now you were quite oriented to one end of your scientific work, namely the outcome, growth and income distribution, etc. But when you look at the other part, and that's your huge contribution that you merge the micro setting with the macro outcome, what would you say for business, for conditions for business, are the most important policy areas to be addressed? Because you need that in order to get that outcome in the other end.
I think my feeling is that success is a combination of various things. You need the market flexibility, the market dynamism. You need to have churning, creative destruction, and you need to have labor creation, job creation, job destruction. That is, we know this is good for growth, and it's good also for social mobility, actually. But to have that well, you need also education. Education is very important. Because otherwise, these processes will increase inequality too much, and they may create, difficult situations. So I think it's very important to put in place, not only to have a very good education system, but then to have a system that accommodates the creative destruction through what I call flex security. Mm-hmm. You need a system where firms can hire and dismiss easily, but where the individual knows that he's never left alone, mm-hmm. that he always has a good income to access for training and to find a new job and to retrain and everything. And that's the big mix to get, you see. I think any country that will manage to have, first, that we have very good access to basic education, so we learn how to learn, and that's why we can easily adapt. And then we have this training and unemployment insurance system that combined with, this labor and product market flexibility, these, I think, are the key ingredients for innovation-based growth. But, of course, you need to reorganize the state accordingly.
And perhaps also the universities.
But the state, you need to have a fiscal system that allows you to probably finance education, health, and flex security, but at the same time does not discourage innovation. And so you need to reform the state. And that's how you think about this. But the good news is that the key policies that are fostering innovation-based growth, which is education, higher education, labor market flexibility, and product market flexibility, they are good for growth, but they can be shown to be good also for social mobility. Things I've not shown because I promised I would not take. And that's encouraging because you can pursue an objective which you call inclusive growth, where growth is for everybody. Mm-hmm.
Thanks, Philippe. I think you took back those 3 minutes just now, actually.
I'm sorry. I thought it was... Oh, God, I'm so sorry.
One more question. Do you go to the gym often?
No, not enough.
Not enough?
No, I do that during seminars.
Shape,
yeah.
I must say. But if you like to sit down for a while and we will bring up the panel and then you'll be
yes,
back.
Yes,
okay,
absolutely.
Okay, great. Thank
and
you
I'm
very much, Philippe.
Thanks so much. Yeah. Thank you.
So we're a little bit, we are on schedule, but we will be a little bit delayed as compared to the program that you have in front of you. But I'd like to ask the panelists up on stage now. So please, Anna Breman, Chief Economist at Swedbank. Magnus Henriksson, Professor and Managing Director for the Research Institute of Industrial Economics. Johan Marklund, director at Vinnova, the Swedish Innovation Agency, and also one of the founders of this prize. And then finally, Annika Rickne, professor at KTH, and also member of the Global Award Prize Committee. Welcome all. Now, of course, you're free to address whatever aspect of Philippe's talk you like. But I think it would be perhaps particularly interesting to focus a bit on the policy agenda. Philippe mentioned some areas here, regulation, flexibility, and education, I think I can summarize it as. And they are all important, of course. Not least education is key. But are there other important areas that we should bear in mind when we're trying to build an entrepreneurial and innovative environment? So that's one track. The other would be then, also mentioned by Philippe, to what extent are we measuring innovation and entrepreneurship? Much is open, it's shared, and it's even free. And the exchange of these services and perhaps even goods take place outside the regular markets. So how can we cope with that, and how can we bring that back to statistics? One way of doing it was illustrated by Philippe through certain ways of estimating these things. But it's a tricky thing, and we need to have better control of what is actually going on in an economy. Those are my opening remarks, and perhaps Anna would like to start, or? Oh yes, you have a mic here.
So first, I'd like to thank you for an excellent presentation and also for excellent research over all these years. I especially appreciate that you're so positive to take in the debate with the policy world. Having an academic background and then moved into policy now to the private sector, as economists, we're dependent on a good discussion with the academics. And you're one of these people who really put this at the forefront of your research agenda, and that's excellent. In terms of, you know, the key drivers for productivity growth, I think you're being very kind to Sweden, and I do agree with you in terms of the reforms that were done in the 1990s did help foster high productivity growth from about 94 to about 2008. However, you also shows that unless countries continue to have good institutions, that might not be the case in the long run. And if we look at the productivity statistics for Sweden and growth since the financial crisis, growth looks pretty decent in an international comparison. But productivity growth, not at all. It's almost zero on average since the financial crisis in Sweden.
Did you measure it correctly?
That's an excellent question, and we'll come back to that. But looking at, my point is really that I think that your research can help inform a new reform agenda for Sweden. Because if you look at Sweden in terms of education, not so great right now. That's one of the key factors. In terms of competitive markets, still okay, but more can definitely be done. In terms of labor market flexibility, there could definitely be more done. So I think it's very nice that you bring up Sweden as a positive example, and I'm very pleased, but I do think that it's time to make more reforms like the ones we did in the early 1990s to make sure that we have innovation and productivity growth in the future as well. Thank you.
Okay, maybe we should hand over to Göran Marklund, who is, as I said, one of two funding or putting up the finance to make this prize available together then with Stockholm's Köpmans Club. Göran, what is your view?
My view is I have a very long time admirer of Professor Aghion's research. And we also had you here 5 years ago to talk in. That was actually in the process of the Research and Innovation Bill coming up then in 2012. It's also very funny. It's never so funny to talk about growth analysis as when Professor Aghion is making the presentations. What I think is important here is the policy things. I think what you did in your research was to restore, I think, the Schumpeterian growth model, which I think was sort of not there, but it was a big message already by Joseph Schumpeter back in the early 1900s. Mm-hmm. And you can even go back further. I think the neoclassicals destroyed what is really the important thing in the growth theory. So what you did was to restore that, which is very important. So then for the policymakers, the first thing is that innovation is the main thing. And you have to look for the incentives that drives innovation. That compass is extremely important. And I think then a little bit building on what you said there, I think it's not really captured still. It's not, I think, what you always do when you think about policy making. How would this affect the incentives of innovating, of creative destruction? And what about the dynamism of the firm population? I don't think it's really there. And what is essential, I think, is to continuously re-innovate the institutional setting. I think you had a lot of stories, a number of stories at least, of countries that may have failed to understand when things turn and when the old institutional setup would not really work anymore. And that's not so easy, though. I'm not so sure. I mean, it's rather easy to say, and I hope you can continue for not another 25 minutes, but 25 years of sort of research on how to design these institutional settings. Because it's something important to say that skills and education is important, and we should invest in that. And you should invest in other kinds of incentives for the firms to innovate. But it's a little bit more complicated to say which reforms would be the right ones in this time when we are right now. So I would like you to come back to us if you get more than 3 minutes to, you know, say which more messages would you have than these things which are important, which is still not really.
But basically, you are stressing flexibility in institutions and a bit of experimental exercises there also, perhaps, though maybe dangerous.
I think you should always, that's a big message, you should always be keen on looking for, is this really incentivizing innovation, renewal in this institution, in this setting, in this, and competition is one of those, of course. And I think you would discover, if you put on those glasses and think around, even including the public sector, is this really driving these people's innovative capacity to the most? I would think you would discover no.
Would you like to see more of guidance for your own sort of the activity that Vinnova is pursuing in terms of more empirical work or how that
Absolutely,
fits
I am.
Yeah. That's what. So that's another research field, perhaps, or there is, of course, research in that field.
It could be now,
but it could be linked to this more clearly. Okay, thank you, Göran. Now, not to co-founder, but a co-founder, namely Magnus Henriksson. What is your take on this?
Yeah, something. First, of course, I believe also that we're underestimating the productivity growth or the value creation in the modern economy. For instance, even with penicillin, I think with penicillin, the price had dropped by 99% before it was included in the CPI, before people died from tuberculosis or from simple problems. And it was included after the price had already gone down enormously. And furthermore, today, with all those services on the internet, there is no rivalry, so anybody can consume it, and the value, what you pay for it, the value is so much higher, and then it doesn't enter the GDP and the productivity statistics, and more services are of that kind. So I think that standard of living has increased in many ways far more than what's captured by the statistics. But the point I really want to make is the following, that what you said about if a firm is on the frontier, then it has to continue to innovate to stay abreast, stay on top. If it's lagging behind, then it doesn't even try. And this is what we see in society everywhere. We see that top companies, they are doing world class, but in many areas, take for instance the Swedish police corps, it's extremely inefficient. And They have no incentive in order to change that. And by the way, because they are so bad, then you get these fantastic companies like Assa Abloy and Securitas and Gunnebo and so forth, that are world-class companies delivering private security services, which give even lower incentives for Swedish police corps to improve, because they don't have to, because instead we buy private services that substitute for what they should have been doing. And you can see this everywhere in society. What really worries me there about what you're saying is that compared to the United States, there you have an educational system with competition, students pay, and everybody's competing for everything. Here we have a monopoly system, and it's education is given away free of charge. And if you don't get enough students, you just lower what you demand from them. And of course, you'll get students and you get paid by the government. But how do you create incentives in a monopoly educational system to really deliver world-class education? And there I'm really worried, and people are totally unprepared to discuss this in the way it should be discussed. So everybody, you have all these vested interests everywhere, and you say that that is key, and this is, I mean, the main challenge for us, and there you see the dualism as well.
Thank you, Magnus. Let's go to Annika.
Thank you. As was mentioned, I had a very great privilege to be part in the selection committee and the prize committee. And as I think Charlie said earlier, we had an enormous database of fantastic names and fantastic researchers, but the choice was not difficult. And we're very happy to have you here. And I think that what I wanted to bring up is that, yes, there are lots of results in your research and what you've done together with your colleagues, but it's also so that I think that you have something to bring to the research community and to teach us in terms of the process. And I was very happy of your speech here because you talked about the journey. And I think what's been very inspiring to me is your way of thinking about theoretical models and matching that to empirical data and going back and forth and not giving up in that process. And I think that's something that's really a challenge for us as researchers, but that's what we need to do. And also what you've been able to do in your research group is to go from the macro to micro and micro to macro, back and forth all the time. And that's what leads us to policy. Because if we don't do all that, we can't come to policy conclusions. So that's really something I encourage you to tell us more about and kind of in this part of your career when you... solved some riddles, at least. There's also a time to diffuse that type of result, because I think that's part also of the educational puzzle we have in front of us, to have very well-educated researchers who can take on this task that you're pointing to, Anna, that we can actually have good economic research that feeds into policy and industry, etc. Of course, I have a number of issues that relates to what are the enigmas, if you will, that are still not solved. I'm really intrigued by hearing more about, so why is it so that innovation can really only explain the top income inequality? And why not the other Gini measures, et cetera? How is it so that we can actually get inclusive growth? Is it so that inequality as such may hinder innovation? So therefore, would we be well off if we would decrease wealth inequality but keep the other processes that keeps us going towards higher innovation? We have, as we all are very aware of, a very interesting and challenging situation right now with high immigration, which means that we have a different set of populations coming into our countries with different skills. How do we feed that process into our innovation and growth wishes and dilemmas? Also, to bring with you for further discussions is the issue of, what do we really mean with innovation? Because now you are actually talking about technology-based innovation, product-based innovation mostly. How are your models holding up for science-based innovation, for organizational innovation? And how is it so that we see that frontline innovation is actually very good for growth, but it's still so that the companies that are the front runners, the ones that are the pioneers, they often fail. So how does that paradox actually go together, and how do we solve that paradox to again come to the incentives that we are needing?
Thank you, Annika. And of course, these aspects of innovation that you bring up are very much in the Schumpeterian vein, where you have five or six categories of innovation. Organization would be one, discovering new markets, another one. It's not only new products and services. Before we let Philippe up here on stage again, did you have any thoughts on, you know, how to cope with this statistical fallacy that we are encountering? Actually, you can enjoy films and world-class operas for no costs at all, basically, or very low cost. How do we come to grips with that, Magnus?
Well, a major problem is, of course, it's not possible to make politics out of this, because if you say that we're mismeasuring it, then you cannot be a leftist politician and say, look how bad it's been for the working class and so on, because it hasn't been that bad. And right-wing people probably can't make politics out of this either, because then left-wing politicians will say, oh, you now you're just pulling a trick in order to try to push under the carpet how bad and how unequal society has become. But so it's very difficult for politicians to pick up on this and exploit it, and that's why we don't see any change. And this is true in America too, I think, because Democrats want to see there's more inequality and they want to make politics out of that. And the Republicans say, like, look, we get more inequality because markets are not free enough, and it's because there is too much government. So there is nobody there to pick this up, and I don't know how to get out of that dilemma.
Maybe you're on those.
I don't know, but I think that is one, filling in on Annika's note, one important message from your research, and one also an achievement. To really point to the lack of data capturing what we're really looking for. So I think that is sort of a challenge for you as researchers, not only for politicians that has to interpret these data, to come up with sort of ideas of what do we do about productivity measurement. What do we do if patent is not covering all kinds of, it's not even an innovation measurement, it's an invention measurement. Because what gets measured gets done, sort of. So it plays with the incentives. So if you cannot measure the police force innovative capacity, as you were quite skeptical about, I think they would have problems even the politicians would have challenges in facing it. And you cannot really incentivize your personnel if you cannot measure it. So you cannot bring up patents as sort of a thing there. So I think it's a challenge for the research community. And as a sort of funder of research, I think that could be sort of a open for ideas that could be researched on, get better measurement on these things. So that is not only a challenge, it's sort of a promise that if you come up with ideas. What the leftists and the right wings would do about it in the meantime, I think Magnus could tell us that.
Göran, you will have a lot of applications tomorrow on your desk.
Well, I'd like to take a little bit of a different perspective, because I do think that there's definitely measurement issues when it comes to measuring TFP growth and productivity, etc. However, there's a global trend that productivity growth is lower, and that trend started already before the financial crisis. Mm-hmm. And even if you say that one percentage point is a mismeasure in the past few years, it's still half of what the productivity growth we used to have in Sweden for the past 15 years before that. Mm-hmm. So I think that, you know, it's very important to talk about how we measure these things, but it shouldn't be an excuse for not realizing that we might still need to look at what will drive growth and how do we get innovation in Sweden or the US or any countries in the future anyways, because I think that there is quite a lot of things we could do quite easily, so some low-hanging fruits that would improve the innovation climate in Sweden, and I think that is worth discussing.
It's good you mentioned that, because the discussion about the productivity puzzle goes actually decades back. So it's not a new discussion, but it seems to be escalating a bit now with new technology. Philippe, why don't you join us here and give your views on what has been remarked upon here. You can have them as a choir behind you, and you be in the front. Or
so you want me to be yes. here, here whatever, in the middle?
Yeah, that will be fun.
Middle, oh my God, yeah. So, I cannot do justice to all the, you know, the difficult questions that have been asked, and I think they would justify, you know, many years of research ahead. So I can just touch upon issues that you raised, because to do full justice, I have to just go back and to my research and keep going. The first question was asked about, you know, concretely in Sweden on education, labor market. Well, I mean, you know, I don't know Sweden well enough, but I can hear from discussing with a Swedish colleague that, for example, education reform, there are things to be done. There are also things that have been tried and have not been as successful as you thought. For example, there are discussions on the grades, you know, going from, in France, we used to have the 400 blows type of school. You see, very, you know, humiliating. And you went through the other, maybe opposite extreme, and maybe there is something, you know, there to rethink a role of grades and grading, which is not humiliating, but which serves as benchmark. The quality of teachers is a very important thing. I mean, Finland, as you know, invests a lot in quality of teachers. They have 5 years after high school, 18 months of training after that, and they are recycled regularly. You have tutors, you have, and there's been work by, you know, Raj Chetty, John Friedman, and co-authors on US data showing the importance of teacher quality. So there, I think you have enormous room for you know, doing more out of it, and that's a big investment, and that's the kind of reforms, you know. In fact, you see, that's the difficulty of the political system. I think there are some reforms where it should be transpartisan. I mean, no matter whether you are social democrat or liberal or whatever the name of the party, I forgot the name of the parties, but you should keep going those things beyond the political alternance, you see, because those are long-term investments, and they should be done. I mean, everybody needs a good to improve schooling system in Sweden. It should be a subject of national interest. The flex security system, to have a true well-working flex security in Sweden, I think it's certainly a first-order thing that everybody would want, and that can be subject of convergence. I think, you know, before you used to have the, like in France I tried to push, you had the left and the right, but I think, in fact, in France now more and more the line becomes between the reformers and the non-reformers, but you have non-reformers on both sides of the spectrum. You have populists on both sides and reformers on both sides. The reformers have to work together. You know, the university system in France was a bit improved because you had the Rocard-Juppé commission. It was a bipartisan commission. And I think more and more we should see these kind of things, or by people who share, you know, beyond their political differences, this view. And on schools, you know, there is, I said, the grading. You have the intertwining between school and enterprise. You know how, you know, in Germany, they are very good at, you know, going through apprenticeship. But of course, so you want an apprenticeship that will still maintain general learning, because you have to learn to learn. How you do that, how you make, you know, that part, what you do in enterprise is validated by diploma, how you can go from more professional and rebound into more general. The Swiss, for example, are experimenting these kind of things. So there are many things that can be also experimented. You can try in some ways and see how it works, you know. And there, I think, there are things. So that's the first question. The second question is that now you have this data. I was mentioning the data, you know, the fiscal patenting and all that. You can look at self-employment. What determines self-employment? Fiscal policy. You can look at effect of various fiscal policy on the type of innovation, or the amount of innovation, or the the quality of innovation. You can look also if there are good innovations, well-cited, original, general, and you can have metrics, and you can look at that, and how fiscal affects. There's been almost no work. All the work on fiscal reform, you had the Merlis the review on fiscal, on tax reform in England. The word innovation never appears. It's a fantastic document, the Merlis review. The word innovation is not there. This is all up for grab. It has to be redone completely. Public finance with innovation. It's a fantastic field, and we have the data. And in Sweden, you have the data for that. The mobility, you said before, you see, it's true what you said on the mobility. It's true that you need to have people choosing and also fighting. In the US, the problem, and that's what Goldin and Katz have shown, is that the tuitions have gone crazy. And that has been a big element why inequality has gone up, broad inequality has gone up so much also, and the middle class has been squeezed out. Is that it's not only that, is that you had things like that. You know, it's not right that some children, some brilliant children, cannot afford schooling because the parents don't have, or that it's an anxiety not to be able to go to college. And one thing is to say you have to incentivize, but on the other hand, money should not be. So you say you have to find a way to have incentives, but not to have, good children from poor backgrounds not being able to get education like you have in the US, which is a huge problem. So the I cannot do inclusive growth. My thing about hope, you know, I'm an optimistic, but there are two ways of being optimistic. You can have the Panglossian way. You know, in Voltaire, you have Candide, and you have a character called Pangloss. And Pangloss says, you know, all is for the best, the better in the best of the world. And he just sits down and nothing, you know, and just stay there. That's not my definition of optimism. My definition is more like a French philosopher called Alain Badiou. And Alain Badiou says, you know, that his view was his father. His father was a resistant. You know, so a number of French collaborated, but some French went into the resistance during the war. And his father used to tell him, my way of being optimism is that I am fighting to liberate France. You see, I mean, and that's my way of being optimism. So I believe it can be done, but we have to fight for it. So when I talk about the mismeasurement or the reason why I don't want to believe that we are condemned to stagnation, it's not just to say, just wait for it to happen. It means to say that they are up for grab. There is no fatality that the digital revolution would destroy more jobs than it would create new jobs. Because we know that big revolution, it's been the case with steam engine or with electricity, it destroys jobs, but it creates new jobs. But whether the job creation becomes more important job destruction, that depends on the labor market, on how you organize the education and the labor market. Yeah, it's up to us to make the digital revolution more labor creating, because you automize, but you create new lines. You see, I mean, I don't want to spend too long, but that's my definition of optimism and the mobility. There is no fatality that you should increase inequality, because if you educate people and train them, it can be the revolution can be a factor of social mobility instead of making more precarious the labor.
We are not victims of the technological development. Rather, we have an opportunity to exploit that to the better for all of us, actually, and that is what you see if you look back in history. I was going to say that maybe one or two questions from the audience, but we're rapidly running out of time and we're competing with drinks. But maybe one then, if there is. You have to be quick. There is one, okay. Okay.
Thank you for a very interesting presentation and good panel. I have one question for you. You talked about increasing competition creates two different fields, one more of the winners and more of the losers. I'm more interested in how can you lift the floor, or instead of cutting the tail, actually bringing the tail along? How can you minimize the level of losers by increasing competition? Is there a way for that?
How can you
minimize the amount of losers, if I understood you correctly? So lifting the tail of the lowest, lift them.
I think you need complementary policies. For example, typically, you need to have policies that retrain workers so that they can go from losing firm to winning firm. So that's why it's very important to have labor market training complementary to product market dynamism. You see what I mean? Because that's what we will make people to be able to move from losing to winning, or to restructure the losing firm and in a way which is acceptable. You see? So that's the idea that you have. It's very important to have several policies in complementarity. I believe that labor market policy is complementary to product market. In fact, there are studies that show it. But similarly, proactive macro policy is complementary to structural reforms. And Draghi is right, in fact. You can show, you can, on firm level data, you can show that there is complementarity as far as growth enhancing the productivity of firms, that, you know, more competition and a more proactive macro policy are complementary. So I believe very much in the combination of policies there to make sure that, of course, you will rebound from the loser to the winner. That the losing firm can become a winning firm. That workers in loss-making firms can relocate to winning firms. Yeah.
Thank you, Philippe. Anna, you have to leave now, and we have to conclude this session. But would you like to say anything, your last remarks? Thank you very much. Magnus, any final comments?
What can I add? So, thank you very much.
You're on. You stick. Annika?
No, that's not. Yeah, sorry, I had all these questions, but we should debate, because I had plenty of answers, but you're fed up with me now.
We take it during the drinks. Thanks to the panelists, and thanks to Philippe.